And the people who control that company, whether it is the Ambanis or the Adanis, etc., they come to control that money, and that money is deposited in their accounts abroad, which is again laundered and brought back in this way. So whether it is these crony capitalists or whether it is these politicians, they are all the government's own people, and therefore this government is clearly not interested in stopping this or bringing it back. And the lack of political will of this government to tackle corruption is also clear from the fact that after coming, they have successfully stalled the appointment of the Lokpal. It's been 2 years since the Lokpal bill was passed. For the last 2 years, though that bill is a weak bill, but even that weak Lokpal is not being appointed for the last 2 years, out of which 1.5 years has been the tenure of this government, the present government. The second anti-corruption, the second most important anti-corruption institution is the Central Vigilance Commission. Central Vigilance Commission, apart from general vigilance and etc., which was its earlier role, was given two other important roles by the essentially by the Supreme Court. One was to supervise the functioning of the CBI, and the other was to be the nodal authority for whistleblower protection and for examining complaints of whistleblowers. But the CVC, the governments, successive governments, including the particularly the present government, has seen to it that the CVC is financially choked off and is unable to perform these functions, because in order to perform these functions, they need their own independent investigative machinery, which has not been provided to them. And no funds are given to them to have this machinery, because the financial control over the CVC is of the government, not just the financial control. Even appointments of the CVC are controlled by the government, because the appointment committee has Prime Minister, Home Minister, Leader of Opposition. Two people from the government, one Leader of Opposition. Leader of Opposition is also usually interested in having weak and pliable people in this post, because their corruption of the opposition when it was in power earlier and when it hopes to come to power in future is also going to be investigated by the same institution. And therefore, for a long time, two posts in the CVC were vacant. Out of three posts, two were vacant, the Chief Vigilance Commissioner and one other Vigilance Commissioner. Eventually, because of a petition, the government was forced to appoint, but they appointed two thoroughly corrupt people who are known to be thoroughly corrupt, against whom we have challenged their appointments, which is pending in the Supreme Court. So that institution has been virtually destroyed. The third institution is the CBI. Now the CBI's problem is that it is, though the Supreme Court gave it some kind of minimal autonomy by saying that the CBI director will have a minimal fixed tenure of 2 years. And it also said that the CVC will exercise supervisory control over the CBI. But that supervisory control has come to mean nothing, because the CVC has no investigators to independently look at CBI investigations. So they have not bothered to supervise the functioning of the CBI, which we have seen. They have not even bothered to do anything about whistleblowers, which we have also seen. We had been saying that the CBI should be placed under the administrative control of the Lokpal, which would be independent of the government. That in that whole Lokpal versus Jan Lokpal bill, this was the fight. This was the main point of contention, one of the main points of contention. But the government was adamant, not just the government, the opposition, all the parties were adamant that no, no. Administrative control over the CBI must be of the government. And the result was that the power, since the power of transfers, promotions, postings, disciplinary powers are all vested with the government, so exercising those powers, the government continues to control the CBI. And we have seen this in innumerable occasions where the CBI stance changes along with the political affiliations of that person vis-a-vis the government. When Mulayam Singh was with the government, the CBI became soft. When Mulayam Singh went against the government, the CBI became hard. Same thing with Mayawati, same thing with so many people. So even that, this government has done absolutely nothing. But one of the most important anti-corruption institutions is the judiciary itself. Because the judiciary exercises two kinds of powers so far as corruption is concerned. Firstly, it's the body which tries offenses, corruption offenses, and thereafter decides whether the person is guilty, gives him the sentence, etc. And the second is this power of the High Court and the Supreme Court to order court-monitored investigations like they did in 2G or like they did in the coal case, etc. So those are extraordinary powers to check corruption and even to order institutional reform. It's the Supreme Court which ordered that CBI directors should have a 2-year fixed tenure, that the CVC should have supervisory jurisdiction, that CVC should be the whistleblower authority, etc. So these are very important functions of the judiciary, and therefore the judiciary is also a very important instrument in this whole anti-corruption architecture. But again, there have been no steps. Today the judiciary suffers from every kind of problem. Firstly, ordinary citizens do not have access to the judiciary because they can't afford lawyers. And 80% people are therefore shut out from even accessing the judiciary. Secondly, the cases go on for decades altogether. Thirdly, even when the cases come to be decided, they are often decided wrongly because of corruption or incompetence. There is substantial corruption in the judiciary. All these things require very serious judicial reforms, which have to be done by the government, by the parliament, by the government, and by the judiciary itself. Unfortunately, the government, neither parliament nor the government, have taken even the minimal or the least interest in any kind of judicial reforms. It's true that the judiciary has still, to a very large extent, succeeded in remaining independent of the government. But it is plagued with all the other problems that I mentioned. Of course, the government was trying to control some of its independence by taking over the power of appointments or appropriating a substantial part of the power of appointments through this National Judicial Appointments Commission. But even that may not fully come through, because most probably the Supreme Court is going to strike down parts of that. But what I'm saying is that those reforms which are required to have an independent judicial complaints authority, to have an independent judicial appointments authority, which would be completely independent of the government, full-time body, completely independent of the government and completely independent of the judiciary, etc., that has also not come. Of course, the judiciary also has to take some blame for this, because judicial reforms are also the duty of the courts. So this government, as I said, there has does not inspire even the least confidence that it is serious about corruption. The nature of corruption, however, has transformed further. Today, there are more exotic kinds of corruption which you and I don't even get any whiff of. For example, corporations, recently the road secretary of the government of India, he gave an interview which was published on the front page of the Hindu recently. I don't know how many of you read it, in which he pointed out that the banks have been responsible, the public sector banks have been responsible for giving absolutely indiscriminate loans to these private highway companies. Highways have been privatized. That's another privatization that has happened, that you have privatized highways. And these companies make projects or make a project proposal in which they project absurd that every year, for example, in that airport metro line which was given to this younger Reliance, this fellow, Anil Ambani, he proposed that we will have 2 lakh people traveling every day to the airport. 2 lakh is probably not even the total passenger traffic. And he said, therefore, we will make so much money, and therefore, please give us loans of 20,000 crores for this particular project, etc. And the banks happily gave that money. And then, of course, you don't even realize 10% of that. So these people default in paying the loans. And then they have something called corporate debt restructuring. And now that corporate debt restructuring is called 5x25 restructuring, which means that you can get your debt restructured 5 times for 5 years at a time, so that for 25 years you can go on restructuring. That means you default once, you come back to the bank and say, okay, look, I've defaulted because this year the traffic was not good enough. Next year the traffic will become 10 times. So you give us another 10,000 crores just now, and from next year we'll start paying you 10 times this much. And the banks restructure that. And again, they default after another 5 years. Then they come back to the bank, oh, there was some problem. But from next year, though, you give us another 10,000 crores, and they go on in this way. And people like you and I don't come to know anything about it. The amount of corporate debt that has been restructured in the last 5 years is over 5 lakh crores. Most of our public sector banks are sick today. Lakhs of crores of our money has just gone down the drain because of these kind of scams that are taking place. In the first place, in a very irresponsible and a corrupt manner, you give loans. Thereafter, when the company defaults and when you are supposed to take over the assets of the company, instead of taking over the assets of the company, you again give further loans saying, ki acha, money has got stuck, therefore this thing will go on. And this is going on. And as I said, this is a kind of scam which ordinary people do not get any whiff about. It's the Reserve Bank which is supposed to be regulating this, but unfortunately the Reserve Bank has done nothing. Same thing happens in the stock market. You see, Harshad Mehta, Ketan Parikh, and that thing, not exactly that thing, but in the stock market, every kind of insider trading, SEBI is supposed to be the regulatory body. Again, it has become a corrupt body. There was one honest officer called Mr. Abraham, who was a member of SEBI, who wrote about this present chairman of SEBI to the Prime Minister, saying that, look, in these insider trading cases against Reliance and some other company, this chairman is asking me to favor Reliance, etc., etc. But nothing was done. He was removed. He was raided. But that chairman is there. That Reliance is going on. Nothing has happened to them. So that's another area which we people don't come to know about, which doesn't touch ordinary people, but that's another area where there is enormous corruption. So we need all kinds of reforms We of course need the Lokpal. We need to reform the CVC in order to make it financially independent of the government, in order to make the appointment process independent of the government. The CBI needs to be made administratively, to be removed from the administrative control of the government and placed under an independent body. We need judicial reforms. We need some changes in the laws also. There was a whistleblower act which was brought, which was a weak act, which essentially made that notification into the act itself, that there was a whistleblower notification which the government had brought pursuant to the Supreme Court's order by which the CVC was empowered. The same thing was reduced to an act. But even that act was not notified, has not been notified by the government. That means it has not yet been effectuated. And before effectuating that, the government has now proposed an amendment under which if a whistleblower sends any information to the CVC which a ordinary citizen cannot access under the Right to Information Act, then that will not be acted upon by the CVC and that whistleblower will be prosecuted under the Official Secrets Act. This is the amendment that has been proposed, which will make the Whistleblower Act totally meaningless. And therefore, nobody now goes to the CVC anymore. No whistleblower goes to the CVC. I receive many more whistleblower complaints than the CVC does. And that's why we are now proposing to set up a citizens' whistleblowing forum, which will do whatever can be done by way of citizens' efforts to ensure that these scams highlighted by whistleblowers, they are at least brought out before the public. If something can be done in the courts, we take them to the courts. If we can do something to provide, to protect that whistleblower from victimization, etc., we do that. And government has proposed one more amendment in the Prevention of Corruption Act. 13(1)(d) is one provision in the which defines criminal misconduct. Criminal misconduct, actually there were certain kinds of offenses where it's difficult to prove payment of kickbacks. So when the Prevention of Corruption Act was made, it was provided that if you have given a largesse to a private company or to a private person without any public interest or by abusing your authority as a public servant, then even if there is no proof that you have taken money, you will be punished for criminal misconduct. Because the presumption was that if you have given a largesse without any public interest, then you must have done it for some extraneous consideration. Now the amendment that has been proposed to the Prevention of Corruption Act seeks to do away with this altogether, criminal misconduct. Conflict of interest is another serious problem. It's actually a problem of corruption, akin to corruption, where, for example, a secretary to the government of India, let's say petroleum secretary, he signs off on a lease or petroleum lease to a particular company, private company. And thereafter, immediately after retirement or taking premature retirement, he joins that very company. Under the present law, that's not an offense. But that's a very, very large source of corruption today in the government. In fact, we did a People's Tribunal on the World Bank and the IMF. And one of the issues was, which I examined was, why is it that the government adopts every policy that is proposed by the World Bank or the IMF, even if that policy is totally against public interest, such as privatization of water? So I examined the records of the finance secretaries, chief economic advisors, and chairman of the Reserve Bank for the last, or the Reserve Bank governor for the last 15 years. And we found that more than half of these people, well over half of these people, had either taken up jobs with the World Bank just before coming to the Government of India or immediately after their retirement or after taking premature retirement. I had a cousin in the administrative service who was in the Department of Economic Affairs, and she was also wanting to get a job with the World Bank, and she told me that it is the dream, particularly of every honest officer in the Government of India, to get a job with the World Bank or the IMF, because in this kind of salary that you get there, in 1 year you save more money than what you have saved in 30 years of your working life in India. So for an honest person, particularly for an honest bureaucrat, it's an excellent way of doubling your savings in 1 year. So that creates a huge incentive in the minds of an honest bureaucrat, if he is hankering for a World Bank job or an IMF job, that he adopts whatever policies the World Bank or the IMF wants the government to adopt. And Stiglitz has written in his book how the World Bank and IMF is controlled by these Wall Street firms and these large multinational corporations, etc. And they act, basically their policies are by and large tailored for the commercial interests of those corporations. So this is another area which needs to be regulated by law. But again, there is no interest in the government to do any of this. So what do we do? As citizens, we can do many things. As I said, we can have these kind of citizens whistleblower forums where whistleblowers can come to us, and we do whatever we can by way of highlighting those issues. We monitor the corruption at our local levels. This organization can certainly do that, this CAG. That is, it can. One of the proposals that I want to make is that you can, in fact, try and do either something like the Transparency International does, do a corruption perception survey of the city, of the state or the city, who are the most corrupt officers, which was an exercise done by the UPIS Officers Association. Alternatively, you can also try and hold public hearings about these officers, get actually evidence of the corruption of these, and then announce who are the three most corrupt officers or five most corrupt officers in the state or the city, etc. I mean, this is one of the things that people can do at the citizens' level. Of course, citizens, I'm not saying that citizens should now not be agitating for institutional reforms or legal reforms. We need to take up all these issues. Of all these institutional reforms that I mentioned, all the legal reforms that I mentioned in the corruption regime. But as I said, unfortunately, that enthusiasm which we witnessed during the anti-corruption, during the heyday or the peak of the anti-corruption movement, is now missing, partly because of the betrayal that people feel by those who were at the vanguard of that movement. So anyway, these are a few brief thoughts, not very brief actually, I've gone on for very long. These are some thoughts that I wanted to share about the state of corruption in the country today, and what could be done, what needs to be done, etc. Thank you very much.